Shall I start then?
1 minute, ma'am.
Hi, Idris. Good evening.
Hi. Kya hal chaal?
Yeah, ma'am. You can start.
E-virtual meet after a long time. Big hiatus.
Yeah.
Yeah, ma'am. You can start now.
Yeah. Let's get started.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Kajal Yadav from MKO Pharmaceuticals Limited, Pune. And I welcome you all for first live program from MP and Chhattisgarh on fight against MI in the era of COVID. And I would also like to sincerely thank Dr. Manoria sir and all the esteemed faculty for taking out valuable time from their busy schedules and participating in today's webinar. So introducing Dr. Manoria sir, I'm sure he does not need any introduction. Dr. Manoria sir is director of Manoria Heart and Critical Care Hospital, Bhopal. He's past professor and head department of cardiology, GMC Bhopal. He's honorary cardiologist, His Excellency the Governor of MP, and past president of API, CSI, ICC, IAC, ISCPT, and GSI. We have speakers, Dr. Idris Ahmed Khan. He's going to present on pre-hospital and in-hospital thrombolysis against MI. He's a consultant interventional cardiologist at Bombay Hospital, Indore. Also, we have Dr. Vinod Somani with us. He's Associate Director, Cardiology at Medanta Heart Institute, Indore. And he's going to present on selective PCI during COVID era. We have three expert panelists with us today. We have Dr. Shailendra Trivedi. He's the Director, Cardiology at Medanta Heart Hospital, Indore. And also we have Dr. Vidyut Jain. He is Consultant Cardiologist at Jodhpuram Hospital, CHL Apollo, and Bhandari Hospital and Research Center, Indore. And we have Dr. Prashant Advani sir with us. He's consultant cardiologist at Advani Heartline and Metabolic Center, Raipur. So without further ado, I would request Dr. Manoria sir to please take over the proceedings.
Good evening, everybody. We have gathered here for the first webinar on fight against TEMI. All of us know we are amidst a pandemic of COVID-19, which is caused by SARS-CoV-2, and this has shocked the entire universe. In India, it has crossed 1.25 lakhs, and nearly 3,700 people have died, amounting to a mortality of only 3%. The state of Maharashtra is worst hit in the country, and all of us know the outbreak began in Wuhan, China, and spread it over the entire universe. And all of us know the COVID virus is pro-inflammatory, pro-thrombotic. And another peculiar feature of the disease is that in the second week, there may be a cytokine storm, which hits very badly and is one of the important causes of morbidity and mortality. So first, we will have the deliberation of Dr. Idris on preclinic and in-clinic thrombolysis. Dr. Idris, please.
Do I run the files from my this thing or what? Kajal?
Yes, sir. You just need to click share screen and then you need to choose that part of your desktop. You need to choose that PowerPoint, sir. PowerPoint.
It's not showing there.
Yeah. You can put it on slideshow.
Okay. So all of you are able to see this now, no?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. So Actually, I think the discussion is likely to be very lively and more engaging. So my part of the slides, although they are 35 or 40, I'll run through quickly because most of the data is known to all the cardiologists and it's available in the public domain. So we'll just have a quick run through kind of thing. And then I think Professor Manoria can handle it later with the discussions amongst the cardiologists. So now, looking at the epidemiology of ST elevation myocardial infarction in India, that important part is that almost 3 million of ST elevation MIs are going to occur in India every year. Looking at various registries, the proportion of ACS, which is likely to be ST MI in India, may be anywhere between 40 to 60%. That is, major number of or the major chunk of patients are likely to present with ST elevation myocardial infarction rather than non-ST elevation MI. In India, we have a different challenge that our patients are likely to be younger as compared to the West, and they may form almost 15 to 16% of population amongst the patients of MI, and it's occurring at an age of less than 5 or 10 years in the younger population. That is, if the average age would be 45 elsewhere, it will be 35 in India. And as I told you, the higher proportion of ST elevation MI as compared to the developed countries. A large number of these patients are likely to come from poor socioeconomic status, which will have a big bearing on how they get ultimately treated. They are likely to present at a long interval between the onset of symptoms. And this delay is again going to make a huge difference in the overall outcome of the treatment. And then, of course, looking at our own ground reality, a patient who is presenting with ST elevation MI, who is poor and has come with a delay, then obviously the evidence-based treatments, they go for a 6, and then obviously it rests on the treating physician or cardiologist how to deal with such patients. And of course, all of this is going to mean a more greater mortality. So these, why do we have these problems? Because of a unique scenario in India, first and foremost, possibly is the lack of awareness of your symptoms. And then obviously people are trying to always mistake this gas and acid kind of problems. It can go both ways actually. People presenting for fear of cardiac symptoms are likely to have acid reflux disorders, but the vast majority actually has the reverse of it. They have cardiac symptoms, they would mistake it for acid reflux disorder. I think this is a global phenomena, but it's much more true in India that such a thing happens. Then obviously a lack of trust would manifest as a person or a patient trying to take just too many opinions. And then even if they have taken an opinion or they have decided to go to a hospital, our ambulances, they are not likely to have proper trained personnel or kits or aids available in the ambulance if something were to go wrong on the way to the hospital. Again, we have two very important and unique issues to our part of the country, to our part of the world, is that we surely do not have a lot of health insurance around. People take small insurance, 50, 60,000, 70,000, that sort of ridiculous amounts of health insurance people buy. And then obviously they are out of money. And looking at this, and in presence of COVID, again, we have had that people were actually run out of money because the banks were not functioning, ATMs were out of money again. Even of those people who had actually presented to the hospital, you will find that they would show an inability to immediately pay up. So during COVID, we have had this. People, I think this will be a big point of discussion today, that where are all the cardiac patients? Most of the patients have actually remained away from the hospital. Very, very few have actually presented to the hospital. Those fortunate enough who have presented to the hospital have not gotten the correct or the adequate treatment because of n number of problems. Then obviously, even if you wanted to check their COVID status, no tests or kits are floating around that you would simply go and use. And there is absolutely no rapid kit test that you would run, and within minutes you would know whether somebody is having COVID or not. All of these are an absolutely different set of problems, which are unique to the entire world, and nobody knows really how to deal with them right now. So that's again going to, I think, going to be a very good point of discussion. And obviously, once you encounter somebody with an acute myocardial infarction who turns out to be COVID, or who was positive and then later on turns up with an acute myocardial infarction, it's going to be a huge challenge to really decide as to what is the best course of action, because it will be really putting the entire staff at risk to take up such patients and expose them. That's again a moral and ethical headache that you encounter. So let us go forward here to the reperfusion strategies that we have in acute myocardial infarction with ST elevation. The gold standard remains primary percutaneous intervention. So go for a primary angioplasty whenever, wherever feasible. So that remains the golden standard. But of course, that's not so easily and always available. Not everybody can be able to afford that. So of course we have thrombolysis, and my own personal favorite last you can see here is lysis, which is followed later on by PCI, and you fashionably call it pharmacoinvasive therapy. So what really matters is that you shorten the time between decision making and then provide what is the best optimal therapy for that patient. So now look at the dismal figures in India. We have less than 50% of patients with STMI receiving thrombolysis or PCI. And the best data is possibly from the state of Kerala, which has been an outlier in so many health problems in India. In recent COVID pandemic also, Kerala has turned out to be an outlier in terms of controlling the epidemic and taking care of its patients. Same thing had happened recently with, more recently with Nipah, a virus outbreak. Again, they were beautifully able to contain that. Same thing applies here compared to the rest of the India. Look at Kerala. They provide 15% of patients with thrombolysis with 1080 plays or an equivalent. Rest of the India hovers around 3-4%. But that also, the best state in India would provide to only 15%. And not that everybody else gets to get an angioplasty. The number remains much, much smaller in that arena also. So how would you choose? The important thing is that the first and foremost you are looking for is to provide the best myocardial salvage that is possible so that you preserve the LV function, which eventually is the lifeline for a given patient. So the effective strategy has to be timely, effective. It should be complete, safe, and easily accessible. Not a very tall order in the current invasive cardiology world. So PCI remains the gold standard. It's preferred, but may not be easily accessible. Thrombolysis is easily available, economical, and of course, if you cannot do a PCI right away, but you can always have the option which provides a bridge between the gap of the bridge between the gap which intervenes in lysis and later on PCI. So with primary PCI, you're definitely going to have high rates of infarct late artery patency, good or better T3 flows, and lesser or lower rates of recurrent ischemia. And all this will also come at a lesser cost or a lesser numbers of intracranial hemorrhages and deaths. So by all means, primary PCI remains superior to thrombolysis, especially for a given time zone. And this PCI-related delay, if it is occurring to going to be more than 60 minutes, then this statement may not stand correct, because thrombolysis to be inferior to PCI is the matter of time. So PCI regains its benefit or remains to be superior at all times only if it can be done without much delay. Now, thrombolytic is beautiful, excellent, if you can do it within first hour or at least up to 3 hours. So that is from the symptom onset. That would be a really good time to do a thrombolysis, even if you had a PCI available, that is. So there you can actually make a choice, an active choice between not doing a PCI if you can thrombolyze somebody within the first hour of onset or at least up to 3 hours. Now that is at all order, because not everybody is going to reach the hospital within that short span of time, recognizing their symptom and not dropping dead, reaching the hospital within that span. But these are the first golden minutes of the acute coronary events, especially with stillation MI, where thrombolysis has the greatest advantage. And this benefit over or equivalence with PCI sharply drops once those first 3 hours are over. And thrombolysis is likely to prevent 30 early deaths per 1,000 patients if they can be treated within the first 6 hours. And we must know and remember that it remains the most practiced form of reperfusion therapy. The disadvantage is being the most important possibly or the most fearful is stroke, that is especially hemorrhagic stroke. And we do have certain patients who are more prone, female, lesser weight, advanced age, prior CVS, and very high blood pressure on admission. These are the chance that they will increase the chance of hemorrhage. Even then, you know, in all of these subsets of patients, we have used it with great success. But here we are. This is one disadvantage, an intracranial hemorrhage that is really frightening and can actually alter the whole outcome of the therapy offered. Then, of course, the second headache is likely to be reocclusion. Reocclusion can occur with PCI also, but the reocclusion rates of 4 to 5% of the infarctulator artery, it's quite high as compared to PCI. But nominally looking at this, the reocclusion rates with current thrombolytic agents remain actually very, very small. So what all thrombolytic agents do we have and how do you actually decide amongst these? We will discuss out of these four that you see on the display, we'll discuss the three which we are actually using, streptokinase, reticulase, and tenecteplase. Streptokinase is the good old kinase that had been available since decades in India. It has a percolation into almost every single nook and corner of the city, including all rural areas. And even smaller GPs and physicians sitting in the smallest corners of India, they are aware and they are well-versed with this molecule. So they have been using it. The most important thing about it being the cost. It's the least costly available drug. It costs somewhere nowadays between 1300 to 2000 only. And since people are well versed with using it, so they can straight away go for it. But the problem with this is that it's an indirect agent. It takes a lot of time to give, a lot of time, 60 minutes happens to be a lot of time in a stillation MI, of course. Patency rates are low, and there is a lot of systemic fibrinogen depletion. So these are things which you would not desire to be there in the current world. So what are the options? And the option had been reticulase and tenecteplase. Again, these two have penetrated the Indian market beautifully, especially the India, made in India ones. And again, people have become very well versed. General physicians are aware that these agents happen to be more successful. Only thing is the initial cost burden happens to be high. But that too, the cost in the previous few years had come down drastically. Both of these are fibrin specific, directly acting, can be given within a short period of time. Although tenecteplase can be given within few seconds compared to reticulase, which will require the 30 minutes interval between the two doses. So there again, time interval makes a difference here, then tenecteplase possibly is the answer. So these are the drugs which we have and which we have seen people using and becoming comfortable with. Then, of course, what do you think about the thrombolytic failure therapy in streptokinase? That's 50-50 again, more or less. There's a good 50% chance that the thrombolysis will be successful, but there is another 50% chance that it may not be so. And RTL patency rate at 90 minutes with streptokinase has been again 50-50 kind. So not a very happy scenario to live with, 50-50. And now when we speak in terms of efficiency in today's world, what would be the best timeline to get a PCI done? So you would like a PCI from the onset of STMI diagnosis and primary PCI strategy, you now speak in terms of few minutes. So we'd like patient to undergo a PCI within minutes, or if they are transferred, they should be transferred and get a PCI within 2 hours. Anything more than that is not desirable. Then the patient should actually be given an advantage of immediate fibrinolytic therapy, especially those ones which are bolus in nature. And then, of course, you can transfer to PCI center. and later on they can undergo whatever procedure is necessary for them. So this is the focus of my talk. Focus means the headline, actually. The bolus fibrinolytic therapy, which is done as a pre-hospital center or a pre-hospital setting type. Now, when Europeans or Americans speak of pre-hospital, they talk of ambulance lytic or lysis being given in ambulances on the way to the hospitals. When I think of India, I do not think of well-equipped ambulances. I think of smaller hospitals which are sitting in the periphery, who have a defibrillator, who have a physician, and who have a syringe and the available drug. And that would be a pre-hospital ambulance-like setting compared to Americans and Europeans. This is what we have, and this is what I think about. So here, you again have the advantage of terictopril being given as a single bolus dose. So obviously, there have been now some numerous studies, but look at the studies from India. We have a study of terictopril with ST elevation myocardial infarction, which this is a retrospective observational study done between 2016 and 17. And then you'll find that the rate of clinical successful thrombolysis now has exceeded 90%. So there's a less than 10% chance that the patient will have a thrombolytic failure or a poor ST elevation resolution. This is an interesting thing which you will note here, the ST elevation resolution, because you have to define thrombolysis success in ways of either pain resolution or ST elevation resolution or both. And several times you'll find, because most of us here are interventional cardiologists, and even if those who are not, they'll find that they give thrombolytic and pain resolves, ST elevation comes down significantly, you are happy that it has worked. But on angiography table, you'll find that the vessel remains occluded. So that's a phenomena. I think we can discuss it later on. But even then, patients always fare well when the pain goes and the ST elevation comes down. So that's always a happy ending, sort of. But taking all of those into account, you'll find that it's more than 90%. So even those tenecti plays which had been made in India or produced in India, they have shown that they provide the same level of thrombolytic success or ST elevation resolution success as compared to the originator molecule. So that gives us a comfort level with our own molecules, because they had been cheaper from the beginning, and they have been efficacious. So in the Indian registries, I would say that overall, less than 5% of patients had a failed lysis, so more than 95% was the success rate. And again, this thing has to be re-emphasized that the success was the maximum in those patients who could reach the hospital in the first 3 hours of pain onset. Mortality remained low, and the intracranial hemorrhage, which we all are afraid of, was again very low, although it's never negligible or zero. So basically, it's all a matter of time. Again, you'll find that it's more than 95% success rate, up to 3 to 6 hours. Below 3 hours, it's even slightly more, but then drastic drop beyond 6 hours. And yes, this is the time when most of the patients in India are actually likely to reach hospital. So that is something that needs to be worked upon. That's a matter of another discussion somewhere. So this, I think we have seen more or less that even drugs which are made in India are good and they provide equivalent amount of benefit. This is, again, something to look at and learn, that if you provide a fibrinolysis in the first 1 hour or 1 to 3 hours, you will find that in so many ways, you will find that fibrinolysis is really good and could be an equivalent or maybe slightly better than primary PCI. But then these patients are really very few. And even these, despite coming in within one to three hours, one would actually morally be responsible to share with them that they can undergo PCI if they want to. Otherwise, fibrinolysis is not going to be a very bad choice. This is the time zone where if this time can be utilized and it comes to India someday, maybe that people who have been diagnosed with MI got to get an ambulance and have a doctor who can actually do and read an ECG, or maybe a very trained nursing staff, they should be undergoing thrombolysis on the way to the hospital, especially in large, dense urban areas like Mumbai or Delhi or Gurgaon, where actually you will have traffic jam and people are likely to take 1 to 2 hours merely reaching the hospital. And that is the time zone which is not acceptable, because on that time zone, we are neither doing a PCI inside the ambulance, and if we are not offering them preclinical or pre-hospital thrombolysis, then really that ambulance is hardly going to be of any use for these patients. So to compare between streptokinase, reticulase, and tenecteplase, I think if it comes to pre-hospital thrombolysis or ambulance thrombolysis or a smallest center thrombolysis with an idea that the patient is to finally reach a PCI capable center or a hospital, I think it should be clear to one's mind that tenecteplase should be the first choice, even when compared to reticulase and of course as compared to streptokinase. Fine, I think they should take care of it. Thank you all. I would request Dr. Munira to take over from here, and we can discuss this matter later on. Thank you, sir.
So you'll have to stop sharing. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll do that. I'll leave and then rejoin. There's some problem here.
Dr. Samani, sir, now you can share your slide. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, good evening, sir. And I think Idris has already told about that thrombolysis and pre-hospital thrombolysis and advantages of thrombolysis in. And I think in today's COVID era, that is more practical rather going straight away for PCI in patients. We have a very good guideline, which is Cardiology Society of India has also framed a guideline that how to deal COVID patient, STEMI patient in COVID era, whether which patient we should take to the cath lab or how we can prevent the exposure of our doctors and our staff by taking what kind of precautions we should take. So I'll just start my lecture. There are new challenges in managing MI patient during COVID-19, as we all aware. Patient delay definitely because of existing nationwide lockdown, lack of transportation, lack of routine medical services, and also a patient fear of contracting an infection. Current non-availability of a rapid nucleic acid test does not permit rapid discrimination of patient COVID-19 status. Limited number of centers for testing for this test, and abnormal troponin values are common among those patients which have COVID-19 infection. So what are the new challenges in cath lab? STEMI care with its inherent urgency has particular challenges. COVID-19 has placed an enormous strain on the healthcare system with implication of the disease on practice in the cath lab. And cath labs in general are not designed to isolate infection, with most having normal or the positive ventilation system, which is one of the drawbacks to deal these kind of patients. We need a negative ventilation systems. The cath lab needs to carefully weigh the balance between staff exposure and the patient benefit. This is a reperfusion of STEMI in COVID-19 era, business as usual according to ACC guideline. And they had divided the STEMI patient, whether COVID-19 or pyrexia of unknown origin, yes, assess the cardiac risk. And according to that, you decide whether you want to thrombolyze the patient or you want to proceed to the primary PCI. Consideration for fibrinogen, there are few absolute contraindication. As we all know, the contraindication which was previously there, they are the same in COVID era also. you have to assess the risk, whether which patient you have to take immediately to the cath lab, like infarinator artery location, hypotension, Killip's class, cardiogenic shock, life-threatening arrhythmia, or delayed presentation. These are the patients in which you have to think whether you should take directly them for the primary angioplasty or you can wait. And consideration for PCI, weigh the risk benefit to the patient and balance against the potential exposure risk of going to the cath lab. Again, they're divided between the high risk and low risk. In low risk, you should consider the fibrinolytic therapy. In high risk, primary PCI, or you can go with rescue PCI in cases where the fibrinolysis is failed. And this is how you can decide. I still feel the fibrinolysis is the best. You can thrombolyze the patient. And if patient is symptomatic, you can take him for the rescue PCI. So acute management of acute MI during the COVID-19 pandemic, there is consensus statement from the Society of Cardiovascular, SCAI, SCC, and SF. At present, presenting with STEMI to a primary PCI center, you have to see whether ST elevation on ECG. If COVID-19 in positive, symptoms consistent with MI, ECG consistent in MI, consider focus to confirm your diagnosis. STEMI, then go to primary PCI. If it is unclear, echo to detect regional wall motion abnormality, serial ECG, portable X-ray, consider COVID-19 myocarditis. And then you have to take a joint decision regarding the coronary CT or cardiac cath lab activation. If it is COVID-19 possible, then symptom consistent with MI, ECG consistent with MI, STEMI, then you go directly for the primary PCI. So primary PCI should be a default strategy in patient with clear evidence of STEMI. If primary PCI approach is feasible, otherwise a pharmaco-invasive approach may be considered. Patient presenting with STEMI to a referral hospital which has non-PCI capable. In these hospital, COVID-19 positive or probable, you can fibrinolyze the patient and send to the DAVID COVID-19 cath labs. In our country, it is practically not possible. We should have a dedicated cath lab where you can take COVID-19 positive patient. But in America and Europe, they might be doing like this. But if COVID-19 possible, then you can send patient to the cath lab and patient can go for primary PCI. This is the ESC guideline for the diagnosis and management of cardiovascular disease during the COVID-19 pandemic. The maximum delay from STEMI diagnosis to reperfusion of 120 minutes should remain the goal for reperfusion therapy under the following consideration. The primary PCI remains the reperfusion therapy of choice if feasible within this time frame and performed in facilities approved for the treatment of COVID-19 patients, a safe manner for healthcare provider and other patient. Primary PCI pathway may be delayed during the pandemic up to 60 minutes. This is one which they have added. Usually we take 190 minutes to 120 minutes, but they gave the grace of 60 minutes in these cases in today's era, according to the multiple experiences, due to delay in the delivery of care and the implementation of the protective measure. If the target time cannot be met and fibrinolysis is not contraindicated, fibrinolysis should then become the first line of therapy. The management of patient with STEMI during COVID-19 pandemic, the same access to care, STEMI network, ambulance, transport to hospital, 24/7 cath lab service, timely primary PCI possible, you can consider a 60-minute more delay. If it is yes, then go for PCI. No, then fibrinolysis. And a cell presenter or hospitalized patient with COVID-19 type of hospital, at hospital with cath lab service, go for primary PCI. At hospital without service, transfer for timely primary PCI possible. And otherwise, do the thrombolysis. The recommendation from the Peking Union Medical College Hospital for the management of acute MI during the COVID-19 outbreak. Almost all hospitals have the similar kind of thing that if it is COVID positive, if you have a dedicated cath lab where you can tackle this kind of patient, you can do primary PCI. Otherwise, best way is to thrombolyze. And then if needed, then you can go for the rescue PCI. If COVID-19 could be excluded by the expert group within 1 hour and possibility of service there, COVID-19 was clinically small, cardiology should evaluate the following two schemes. monitor closely, conduct emergency coronary intervention immediately, and elimination of COVID-19. Proceed with on-site thrombolysis. Make the treatment decision after comprehensive consideration of benefit risk ratio. During thrombolysis, review the ECG, bedside echo, and chest X-ray. After thrombolysis, check the recanalization status of myocardial perfusion, and you may perform a chest CT immediately. CSI on acute MI care during COVID-19. The Cardiology Society of India, they also have a document on acute MI care during COVID-19. And we have all our colleagues all over the India, they have made a very good flow chart and that how to take care of these patients in today's COVID-19 era. The Cardiology Society of India acknowledged the sincere efforts of all the various bodies, like all institute, hospital, local, and all other health authorities, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, in devising response plans to contain, mitigate, and suppress this pandemic. The purpose of this position statement is to supplement, not to override valuable guidance from these bodies. The recommendation regarding reperfusion strategy for AMI, screen every patient for history of any international travel or contact a COVID-19 patient and fever with respiratory system on presenting at the first medical contact. This is the most important, that you should screen each and every patient. The respiratory status of patient should be assessed and classified. Patient presenting with acute MI could be classified into three groups. First, confirmed COVID-19 patient, that is group A. A positive COVID-19 test required rare is the community in India, but their number could grow gradually and increase testing and community spread. Suspected COVID-19 patient, that is group B, who have a history of international travel or close contact of a definite COVID-19 patient and had symptom of fever or some respiratory system, rapid test would permit quick classification of this patient. So for group A is confirmed, group B is suspected, and the third group patient with low clinical probability of being a COVID-19 patient, confirmed non-COVID-19 patient, that is group C, no symptoms suggestive of influenza and no history of travel contact with a COVID-19 patient, and COVID-19 test is negative. This is current stage of epidemic in India. So club group A and B together due to non-availability of rapid testing for decision regarding reperfusion strategy. So we have to take care of group A and B similarly. For the confirmed or suspected COVID-19 patient with STEMI presenting within 12 hours and with no contraindication, thrombolysis is the prudent option to avoid the delay and for protection of cardiac catheterization laboratory personnel, especially if the patient is stable. So they clearly mentioned any patient with STEMI who comes to your hospital, if he is hemodynamically stable, you should thrombolyze that patient first. If the patient is hemodynamically unstable, then primary PCI would be an ideal option, especially if the COVID-19 is assessed as mild to moderate. Thrombolysis should still be tried even if patient is unstable with a plan for rescuplasty due to prevailing logistic problem in our country. So they are very clear in their discrimination that which patient you should take to the lab and most of the patient you should thrombolyze. PCI would also be desirable option for failed thrombolysis, rescue PCI, or a delay presentation beyond 12 hours, especially if pneumonia mild to moderate and appropriate PPE kit is available to you. Primary PCI should not be performed if adequate PPEs are not available, preferably performed in an isolated cath lab where minimum trained personnel to reduce the nosocomial spread. And group C patient of STEMI, utilize pre-COVID-19 strategy as per protocol guidelines, but based on prevailing logistic, thrombolysis could be considered to decrease the overall critical care and patient safety burden. For the stable NSTMI patient, coronary angiography and or PCI should be deferred until a COVID-19 negative test has been obtained. They are very clearly said that you should not rush to the cath lab in non-ST patient, non-ST elevated MI patient. You should test first COVID negative, and if it comes negative, then only you should do angio and the procedure. For the confirmed or suspected COVID-19 patient, thrombolysis should be given in an isolation room area with the designated ICU as an institutional protocol. in small towns and villages and at the spokes and hub and spoke major of STEMI care, thrombolysis should be the preferred reperfusion strategy. Institutional transfer should be discouraged. COVID-19 and the cath lab. COVID-19 has placed an enormous strain on the healthcare system. Specific implication of the disease on practice in the catheterization laboratory. This is a dynamic situation and one for which there are limited data. Local condition may vary considerably. So we might modify practice for a standard cardiac patient, those who are suspected COVID-19 patient, and those patients with COVID-19 who are either unrelated cardiac condition or manifestation. So the disruptive effect of COVID-19 pandemic on healthcare services. COVID-19 is a new pandemic with enormous impact on the health specialty, intensive care unit, staff, and equipment. Cardiac cath labs are not an exception. To improve safety of our patient and staff, we must recognize our inflow and procedural steps and implement new restrictive measures where how we perform the procedure. If at all possible, these measures should be implemented before we get the major outbreak of this pandemic in our community. Perform procedure safely and only in the designated environment, COVID designated environment, dedicated COVID lab for COVID patients. Implement the protocol for operator and staff protection PPE during the procedure. All healthcare workers involved in the procedure must wear a proper PPE arrival of the patient in the echo lab. Implement proper protocol to disinfect the cath lab room after the procedure. So this by these, how to prepare your cath lab operation during COVID, reduce the volume of cath lab procedure. This is the first and most important thing. Categorize the elective diagnostic and emergent procedures. Postpone unnecessary procedures. Reduce the number of interventionists during the procedure. The catheterization laboratory considering during the coronavirus pandemic from SEC Interventional Council and SCAI. So avoid elective procedure on patients with significant comorbidities or in whom hospitalization is expected to be more than 1 or 2 days or requirement of intensive care unit is anticipated. You should avoid elective procedure. Procedures that can be postponed are PCI for stable patients, endovascular intervention like iliofemoral disease or claudication or PFO closure. These kind of procedures should not be done. Individualized decision should be made, weighing the risk of COVID exposure versus risk of relaying diagnosis or therapy. In a STEMI patient, in relatively stable STEMI patient infected with COVID and fibrinolysis is a choice therapeutic option. When primary PCI is performed in STEMI patient with acute COVID, personnel should wear PPE, they're all gear, protective gears. The use of powered air purifying respirator system is also reasonable, in particular for vomiting patient or those who require CPR and intubation. Patient who requiring intubation, suctioning or CPR, increase risk of exposure with procedure as intubation, suction and CPR due to aerosolization of respiratory secretions. So intubation of infected patient should be done prior to reach to the cath lab. HEPA filters between tube and bag when bagging a patient has suggested. Other suggestions include use of closed circuit BiPAP machines and coordination with critical care, ID and anesthesia team to prevent spread of infection. Exposure of staff to infection may result in staff shortage. So a specific consideration like separation of individuals with overlapping skill, some procedure like pulmonary catheter placement, pericardiocentesis, IABP can be performed bedside to avoid transport of the patient. One separate lab or procedure at the end of working day when considered the requirement of terminal cleaning of the cases in suspected COVID patient. Protection of healthcare worker and PPE, N95 mask and skilled in doffing and donning of PPE. This is also an important that how to wear and how to take out. In some situation, positive air pressure respiratory system may be needed. Working with institutional infection control to ensure adequate availability, training in use of PPE. Patient with suspected COVID-19 should wear a surgical mask and personally should done PPE. A shortage of N95 masks as well as gown, gloves, regular surgical masks support deferral of elective cases and reduction of personnel during the procedure. So what they do in China, how to balance acute MI and COVID-19, the protocol from Sichuan province, a provincial people hospital, they have made some protocol that how they manage. So like if any STEMI patient comes, they do the fast nucleic acid test. STEMI patient with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 infection pneumonia, are vital sign, if vital signs are stable, then they see the onset of time. If it is more than 12 hours, if it is no contraindication to thrombolysis, no, then performing thrombolysis therapy in isolation ward. But if they have any severe pneumonia or onset of time, STEMI time is more than 12 hours, then they performing thrombolytic therapy in isolation ward, the same. If recanalization is there, continue the treatment in isolation ward, elective PCI after recovery from COVID-19 pneumonia. If recanalization is no, then comprehensive assessment, benefit and risk of emergency PCI. They assess the benefit is risk and then only they perform the procedure in isolated catheter room or continue the treatment in isolation. So epidemiological history, temperature, ECG, chest, CT, and laboratory tests, these are all required to exclude COVID-19 infection, onset time, contraindication to thrombolysis, and the same old protocol which we are following, that if we exclude, then we can go straight away to the cath lab. But if there is any doubt, we should try to thrombolyze, settle the patient, and if needed in urgently, then only we should do the rescue PCI. So general principle, choose the nearest center with PCI treatment. Avoid public transportation. Patient who are suspected, diagnosed with SARS, COVID-2 isolation and thrombolytic therapy immediately if within repercussant time. High-risk patient with contraindication for thrombolysis, assess their infection and benefit of PCI. Perform PCI only for culprit vessel. And these are the protocol from this Chinese hospital, that stable patient, when the onset of time is within 12 hours, use thrombolytics. For a stable patient, when the onset time is more than 12 hours, evaluate the risk of PCI versus infection on echo in 24 to 40 hours. Follow-up should be performed through an internet outpatient clinic. For unstable patient with severe pneumonia, admit to isolation ward. Unstable patient with mild to moderate pneumonia, assess the onset time of STEMI and follow above the protocol. For non-STEMI patient, the door to balloon time in non-STEMI patient is not critical in most of the patient. Therefore, first exclude the SARS-CoV-2 infection. Any confirmed case should transfer to the isolation ward until patient recovery and then assess for the further invasive intervention as and when needed. So these are the practical protection and preventive measure according to the ESC guideline. The key measure is staff and patient education, management of visitors, review infection prevention policies and procedure, pre-training of wearing protection clothing, environmental clinic and hand hygiene, terminating the use of AC and keep windows open for ventilation, division of the ward area into contaminated, transition and clean region to reduce the chronic infection under the expert of infectious disease. For suspected or confirmed patient with COVID-19 in our department before transfer to designated isolation ward, following measures are defined. Single patient room equipped with air sanitizer, limit the range of patient activities, environmental clinic and disinfectant per day, contact precaution. For patient excluded from infection, mask wearing, external visit forbidden, PPE applied, level 1 protection. Equipment, surgical mask, N95 respirator, disposable cap, isolation gown, medical gear, rapid hand disinfection solution, applied setting, clean or transition region of the workplace. Level 2 protection, the equipment, disposable cap and goggles, N95 respirator, disposable protective overall medical gloves, cover rapid hand infection solution, applied settings, the same. And in level 3 protection, where all this level PPE is applied, and almost same things you consider here also. So protect yourself first, not only to avoid getting infected, but also importantly prevent nosocomial infection. It is reported that 41.3% our COVID-19 transmission is presumably hospital related in Wuhan. This is what they come to the conclusion, that more than 40% transmission is hospital related. Appropriate PPE is paramount as per national and international advisories. preferable to intubate patient with borderline respiratory status before wheeling this patient to the cath lab. Echo should be ordered only if it contributes to decision making. The other consideration for health system and management of non-infected cardiovascular patient, you minimize the COVID-19 exposure, and key consideration for cardiovascular is that procedure, cardiology, interventional, EP, cardiac surgery, you should cancel elective procedure, minimize the staffing in urgent and emergent cases, use negative pressure catheterization lab operating room for urgent procedure, consider the fibrinolysis in cases PCI is not feasible. In cardiac critical care, wear appropriate PPE according to institutional and international guideline. Use airborne PPE with intubation and SELS and favor external compression device for CPR. For echo, cancel elective procedures, use bedside studies, clean the machine and probes after every examination before and after each use, shorten the exam length and use airborne PPE with transesophageal echo. So to summarize, the present COVID-19 pandemic is a medical emergency for an unprecedented scale. On a global scale, not only the medical preparedness to handle this contagious disease, but also change the paradigm for management of everyday procedure. The risk to benefit ratio of primary PCI versus lytic therapy to both the patient as well as the hospital personnel will have to be assessed. If hospitals are overwhelmed with COVID-19 patients, the feasibility of timely primary PCI is a challenge and situation should be dealt in accordance with the available resources. For cath lab staff and patients, consider essential life-saving procedure with suspected confirmed COVID-19. All staff must use maximal PPE and re-establish a safe environment once the case is over. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Dr. Manolia, sir, you're on mute. Sir, you're on mute. You have to unmute yourself.
You have unmuted. I have been. Achha, now you are able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Somani, for a very exhaustive discourse on PCI in the COVID era, incorporating various guidelines. Now we'll discuss some of the problems which we continue to face. First, Dr. Idris, sometimes,
yes,
Dr. Idris, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, sir.
Sometimes we have patients of STEMI who have no fever, no cough or other symptoms, it is suggestive of COVID. And sometimes they can taken for the cath lab because of some hemodynamic deterioration or other reasons. An angiogram is done, and after a day or two or three, as has happened in many hospitals, they are found to be COVID positive, thereby imposing risk of transmission to the ICU and cath lab personnel. So how do you tackle this problem and what is the solution to this problem that we face? Dr.
Okay. I would say that how we have been dealing with this problem so far is, since the COVID tests are absolutely not available to any of us, we treat everybody as COVID positive. We believe that everybody is COVID positive unless stated otherwise. Because even seemingly innocuous patients coming with the urological emergencies, orthopedic problems, they turn out to be COVID positive maybe 8, 10 or 15 days later also sometimes. So going as an interventional cardiologist or taking care of sick patients in today's world, you have to first and foremost believe that everybody is COVID positive. That is what we have been doing. Anyway, we have done very, very few procedures. In the month of April, our score was practically zero because nobody approached us. Not that we are not available. Hardly any patients were able to reach the hospital. In the month of May, we have done about 30, 35 procedures so far. And in all of them, since we have no screening procedures available, the single most important thing that we do is the patient is provided a proper mask, because it's an aerosol-borne disease. It's an airborne disease practically. And the greatest likelihood of catching the disease for an interventional cardiologist is not by doing a femoral puncture, but it is going to be by way of patient breathing or coughing later or sometime. So whatever procedures we have done with the belief that the patient was positive, because we have no way of ascertaining that. And the single most important thing that had to be done was not only that our most of the staff or everybody was properly donned with PPE or an equivalent N95 masks are a must, and we, you know, augment that with a normal surgical mask over that to avoid any dampness or wetness on the N95 mask. And we have done those procedures because several diagnostic procedures have turned out to be patients having surgical decision made in them, and no surgery has been done without getting a COVID, which again, since was not possible, patients had to be isolated. So we have no idea whether anybody is COVID positive or not. We believe everybody is COVID positive before taking them on table.
When we look at the reality of this PCR test, suppose our All India Institute at Bhopal is doing this, it does not take much time. So when these patients are admitted there, they do themselves, they do not do it for others. It hardly takes 1.5 or 2 hours. So what I feel that this test should be available to all the cath labs, so that if there is doubt, they can at least do this test and get the results rapidly. But otherwise, in the usual government setup, you give the sample, it comes after 24 hours, sometimes even 48 hours. So I think something should be done to expedite this issue so that these kits are available at least in the cath lab hospitals. So if there is suspicion and patient has got hemodynamic deterioration, at least you can have an idea.
That could be an ideal world to have,
doesn't do tests for anybody who is admitted outside there. But the test doesn't take too much time, the PCR test.
Yeah, the procedures, government procedures, they take a lot of time. Because since the government has invoked the National Disaster Management Act, we can do nothing about that.
Depending on the number of tests which are sent.
My own test report came after 7 days. Even if they receive a sample, they are not able to run the test for 7 days.
Dr. Somani, another problem which we face is when we have patient of STEMI or even non-STEMI, there are a lot of STEMI mimics, there are a lot of non-STEMI mimics. As you know, the heart can be affected by various pathogenetic mechanisms. There could be myocarditis, there could be cytokine storm hitting the heart, stress cardiomyopathy, pulmonary embolism is not uncommon. So when you diagnose STEMI, how do you confirm that the patient is suffering with STEMI? Troponin levels are also not reliable, as you said, because they can be elevated due to so many reasons. So how do you document that the patient is suffering from STEMI?
I think as for STEMI, as our oldest training, right from the history, and the ECG is most important, because in today's era, ECG and echo, these two things can confirm, because all enzymes are false. All enzymes can raised in other things also. In our institute, we started in between one like COVID panel. But after some time, we realized that COVID panel is not useful for the patient who has cardiac problem, because all LDH, ferritin, and other D-dimer, and everything get raised. And you get confused whether it's a COVID positive or it's something else. So I think the ECG and echo, these are the two things and the history of the patient. Because troponin sometimes give you false report. So these are the things by which we confirm.
I think all biomarkers are highly fallacious because they are released from the heart. They may be released secondary to pulmonary embolism. They may be released due to so many other reasons. What is this problem has been studied by many hospitals. What they found, ECG also is highly fallacious. You may have STEMI because of myocarditis or epicarditis. What they found that if you have in an echo, regional wall motion abnormality in the area of a coronary artery where this is suspected.
Yeah, that's true.
This is perhaps maybe more useful, because ECG mimics STEMI many times. They are taking a STEMI and they find that the angiogram is normal. Dr. Somani, what types of STEMI you are getting in this era? Type 1, type 2?
No, I didn't get it, sir.
What type of STEMI? Type 1, where the coronary artery plaque rupture and atherothrombotic occlusion, or type 2, there's no coronary occlusion and there's a demand and the supply problems?
Sir, most of the STEMI we are getting type 1. The plaque rupture and the thrombotic artery is totally occluded. These kind of patients we are getting.
Dr. Shailen Trivedi, you can hear Dr. Trivedi? Dr. Shailen? Dr. Shailen Trivedi?
I think, sir, he has lost his connection. He'll connect again, sir.
So Dr. Vidyut Jain is there?
Yes, sir. We have Dr. Vidyut Jain, sir.
Can I talk to him? Dr. Vidyut?
Sir, I think he's also not, he's also lost his connection. We have Dr. Prashant Advani, sir.
Dr. Advani is there anyway. Dr. Advani, what is the current status of HCQ for prophylaxis? Because we are exposed, our hospital staff is exposed. So what is the current status of prophylaxis for HCQ?
So there's quite uncertainty prevailing, but that what we are following is ICMR guideline. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
ICMR guidelines, and then I'm like the high-risk healthcare personnel like us, I'm taking weekly 400 mg per week. Just to anticipating a dodge or a subputative infection, as Dr. Idris was saying, every such respiratory infection like a patient or a fever with respiratory-like symptoms would be considered to be COVID positive until proved otherwise. So it's prophylactic dose that ICMR has recommended is 400 mg OD and for 7 weeks consecutively. But probably I've exceeded 7 weeks now. So this is my, and this is a general one.
The ICMR first.
You asked for prophylaxis or for management?
Prophylaxis.
Yes, sir.
The ICMR has recommended first, then put down and down a day or two earlier. They've again recommended 800 milligram on the first day, and as you said,
then weekly, twice, yeah. Then weekly.
Every weekly. And how long actually would depend on, are you still at a risk of exposure?
Yeah.
So prescribed period is 7 years, but if you are working in a hospital, you have COVID positive, I think that can be expanded. Dr. Idris, heart failure is also not uncommon in these patients. So what are various causes of heart failure and how do you manage it? Dr. Idris, can you
hear?
Heart failure in COVID era is not uncommon. So if you have a patient of heart failure, what are the pathogenetic mechanisms in your mind and how do you treat it?
Yeah, the heart failure component would result more or less like a myocarditis-like phenomena in these people. But there is a vascular toxic phenomena which goes on along with the cytokine storm that these patients are prone to. And there's a lot of thrombosis in the smaller capillaries and vasculature that's going on. So, but the heart failure per se, the part of management of that, I wouldn't say that would alter very much between any two different heart failure patients, whether they are COVID positive or negative. And if so far as concerned about giving HCQ in these patients is concerned, I think vasculature at micro level is involved in these patients. I think HCQ is a bad idea. I would rather avoid it. In fact, I've been asking my physicians not to consider it a miracle therapy in management of HCQs in COVID, whatever, even if it is pneumonia alone, because myocardium involvement may not always be visible on ECG or in terms of overt heart failure or myocardial infarction. Cardiac enzyme levels, they go up very fast in these people. And that obviously would contribute to their heart failure.
I think this has also been studied by various associations in hospital. Now, whenever we have a patient of heart failure, we must consider several possibilities. Myocarditis, you said, direct involvement of the heart by the virus. Then cytokine storm is another very important cause. And there are ACS mimics or ACS type 1 or type, and pulmonary embolism must always be considered because a lot of patients have pulmonary embolism. Initially, this was not taken into account. And for cytokine storm, I'll show you now a mechanical device is also available. And cytokine storm usually comes up in the second week and produces multiple organ failure and may result in a fatality. Dr. Somani, and stress cardiomyopathy is another cause of heart failure. Any experience of stress cardiomyopathy occurring in the COVID patients?
No, sir. As per in last 2 months, I have not seen any stress cardiomyopathy patients. But my only worry whenever we the patient with suppose a STEMI come with failure and their X-ray chest is misdiagnosed, And this is the time when it said you have to decide whether you are dealing with the failure or you are dealing failure with COVID positive. And, you know, it's very tricky. And you send patient for CT chest also to reconfirm what is the diagnosis. These are the patient which really create so many problems in management. But otherwise, as I'm agree with Adris, that there is no difference in management of heart failure, whether it's a COVID positive or negative. Heart failure has to be managed as over the standard protocol.
Dr. Idris, thrombotic complications are also increasingly recognized in COVID patients. You have DVTs, you have pulmonary embolisms, and today we have seen one patient with a pulmonary artery embolism in one of the webinars. So what is your strategy for anticoagulants in these patients? You give it for all, or you give to serious patients who are admitted? How long and which?
One-to-one, I have not had to deal with any patient of COVID. It's only an academic discussion for me because our hospital was designated as green zone right from the very first day of pandemic. It's only through academic reading that I can say. And what happened actually, and what I'll tell you what is going on here in Indore is that every single patient who is suspected to be COVID right now in Indore, in the past 45 days at least, everybody is put on anticoagulation because a little late, maybe a couple of weeks after the start of pandemic in India, much later after the world came to know of it, it was realized that peripheral vasculature was getting involved. People are coming up with gangrene of toes and fingers. So they realized this earlier on, it's now almost 4.5 weeks, and the MY hospital and all the subsidiary hospital run by the government right now, they are all receiving anticoagulation therapy at least for 2 weeks. So they keep them in the hospital for at least 15 days. So all those while everybody is receiving is this anticoagulation. One, for the reason that maybe there is an involvement of peripheral vasculature. And secondly, they realize that people who recovered eventually would still die of pulmonary embolism and they can develop a delayed deep vein thrombosis and PTE. So anticoagulation, I think, remains of paramount importance in these patients. One, not merely because the COVID virus is going to cause it, but they are likely to remain bedridden for quite some time. DVT prophylaxis should be a must.
The virus produces endothelitis, so thrombotic complications initially were not recognized,
but itself you know, is highly thrombotic.
Very important cause, even death for many patients. May have heart failure secondary to pulmonary embolism also. But somehow these patients are not properly investigated because of fear of getting infections from the physicians. We had one physician from nearby places. He has recovered all parameters, but ultimately died of pulmonary embolism on the last day when he was going to discharge. But he had DVT, but somehow they don't get the investigations for all this. Dr. Shailen, you have come.
Yeah.
So, what is the current status of passive immunization in patients with COVID? We have a lot of news initially, but now the enthusiasm is not there. Immunization, this passive immunization, injecting convalescent serum of patients who have already suffered from COVID.
Well, in Indore, I think in the MRTB hospital, the chest institute, they have given it to 4 or 5 patients, and in
any idea about the results?
Yeah, they means as far as I have spoken to Dr. Saril Bhargav, and he is the in charge of chest department here. So he told that all 4 of his patients, their symptoms and their severity of the disease was reduced in them, and all of them were discharged. But I think it's very small data to conclude anything, because 80% of the COVID patients, they get their disease regressed in most of the cases. So for 4 patients they have given, and maybe 3 patients in Aurobindo.
Dr. Vidyut Jain, can I talk to him?
Yeah.
Dr. Vidyut Jain, there's a lot of scare of this hydroxychloroquine QT prolongation also with azithromycin, which was prescribed as one of the therapy. So yeah. What are your comments on this QT problem, drug-induced azithromycin, hydroxychloroquine? Any comments on that?
First we'll come to hydroxychloroquine. we first have to tell the patient it doesn't prevent the disease, possibly reduce the cytokine storm related complication, the severity is less. That is to be convinced. Number two, at present, it is supposed to be given in health worker or persons who are directly exposed to the patient, maybe paramedical, maybe the health surveyor people. And definitely QT prolongation is one of the issue. So every patient should not be given blindly. Those who are aged and beyond 50 or so, they should get their ECG done first. Those patients who are taking any cardiac medication for any reason, like whatever cardiac drug he is taking, he should consult his cardiologist first, whether this drug is suitable for him or not. Beyond the age of 75 also, one should be very careful. And below the age of 15, one should be careful. Combination of azithromycin with hydroxychloroquine is not very good. One should be very careful. It should be given only in a hospital setting, if at all indicated. We do not know how much these both work together, particularly for treatment purpose. As for the reduction of the severity of complication due to cytokine release, possibly there is some scope using hydroxychloroquine in selected patient with precaution.
Now, as you see, as all of us know, cytokine storm is a very important factor for changing the outcome of patients, an important cause of morbidity and mortality. And in some of the European countries, this mechanical device has also been approved. You can see on the slide, the CytoSorb, which mechanically removes all these cytokines, IL-6 and others, and have been found to be useful in those patients where there's a cytokine storm. This diagnosis is usually made by elevation in the levels of IL-6, but even when IL-6 is not available, if there's a clinical history that first week, no other organ, second week, the heart is involved, the kidney is involved, and other multi-organ failure, this can also be tried, and you can see the results. The red one, all these parameters are improving after this device. This iron pump is also used in some of the hospitals in Mumbai, but European countries, it has been used in many countries, and some of them have produced good results. It should not be used as a last resort. That is not that the patient has become very, when cytokine storm hits the patient, that is the right time. So this is another advance which is being tested, but I am not sure it is used in India in other centers. And this is the last slide is for Dr. Advani. You are back to work, so you would avoid men or follow men and follow women. Dr. Advani?
Yes, sir.
You will avoid men, follow women, or what will you do? What? You are back to work, you have to get away from the COVID. So you will follow women. So W stands for wash your hands.
Follow women, sir. It makes sense here.
Yes.
Legally, we can follow women.
Yes. Avoid men, you have to avoid mouth, eyes, and nose. So that is, you have to follow men. And that is
wonderfully
the message.
Wonderfully written. Wonderful.
Back to work. If you follow women, you will be prevented from COVID. If there are any comments or suggestions from the other.
Yes, sir. I wanted to raise a thing to Idris and you also, sir, Dr. He presented that Tenecti place with the administration. There's a 90% patency rate in hospital, IR-related patency rate, lesser recurrent ischemia, infarction, and reocclusions. And most of the MIs, ACS, STEMIs that we are seeing are basically hemodynamically stable, electrically stable, inferior MI, inferior wall MI without RV infection, involvement, affliction, or lateral MI without hemodynamic compromise, or mid-LAD plaque rupture, or stable anterior wall MI without severe LV dysfunction. So can't we make in this COVID era, sir, a bolus dose of Lexim as a standard of care for the timing for 2-3 months, and even if the thrombolysis is successful, so you don't have to take him for any subsequent PCI, otherwise which like guidelines recommend. So no pharmaco-invasive, only successful thrombolytic approach.
Dr.
Edris,
depends on the subset of
vision.
Dr. Edris will reply you.
Yeah,
I think.
Does it make sense for coming 2-3-4 months?
I don't know what difference those 2-3-4 months are going to make, but I think it should become a norm for the time being.
Yeah.
We do not know what
is. As you said, that pharmacoinvasive is your best choice otherwise.
Yes, this is my best choice. I am a lazy cardiologist, I must say, because if somebody wakes me up at 2 o'clock with an ST, even an interval MI, so I would rather have them thrombolyzed and reassess them in the morning. I am not shy of coming in the night, but that's never my first choice. I'm not never feeling energetic enough in the middle of the night. But other than that, I have realized that with the advent of these newer thrombolytics, the cath lab work has become much easier. Even if if somebody comes at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and they are within, say, 2 or 3 hours time, I still get them thrombolyzed. Not because I'm going to take a lot of time to take them to the lab, but I find a more cleaner, neater, and less groggy vessel while doing an angiography, and my angioplasty results, I feel, are much better for the patient and myself. That is why pharmacoinvasive looks good to me, especially in those patients who are coming well within
good time. Preferential lytic agent of your choice, the list that you have enumerated?
I would, without doubt, say tenecteplase is my first choice. There is no doubt in my mind.
Dr. Idris, yes, can I interrupt? Dr. Idris?
Yeah, please, sir. Yes, sir.
You remember your own patient when I had come to your lab? That lady who had cardiac arrest in the just beginning of this COVID era,
yes,
and you had a patient of COVID already there. And I was also scared, but I think that step was correct, whatever it was, because we did a hemodynamic, she was hemodynamically compromised, and she had a sudden cardiac arrest also at home. And she survived, and she's better today. Now, so timely done, and explained risk to the for our staff, protection is also very much important. But at that time, I think we had hardly 1 dozen cases in the town. Today, of course, we have 2,000 cases. So then these are more frightening, but when the patients, we are hardly 12 cases in the town, out of which your hospital is maximum, four or five.
Yes.
But even then, everything went up well. So some patients deserve it and some patients did well.
But I would say, anybody, whatever era this pandemic may last for a couple of years at least, I would say, we just have to be, we can never be called over cautious. We have to take precautions. And whenever humanly required, when somebody actually has a hemodynamic or electrical instability, we have to maybe risk our own and our staff's lives and health. And we have to offer them this because this is what we are trained to do and this is what we are supposed to do.
Yes.
So this is no suicidal tendency in myself. But whenever it comes to risking your life while you are trying to save somebody, I think we should not be shy of doing that.
Yeah, nothing. Because our staff is very, very important to us.
Don't forget, there are only two things which come when you are not even aware of. One is love, another is corona. You will not be aware when it is pandemic.
Yeah, you are very romantic today.
Manurya, sir, one more concern. Sir. A diabetic COVID positive case, 47, 48, and he's in ICU, and their ECG shows with worsening symptoms, somebody done an ECG, ST elevation, very categorical, very conspicuous, in 1, 2, 3, AVF, V4, 5, 6, and troponin elevation and ground glass opacities on CT scan. How do you know that it's a type 1 MI, type 2 MI, and how would you ascertain? And
most of the MI in most of the society's experience in most are type 2. Type 1 MI, somehow this plaque rupture is much less commonly seen in all the series.
Yeah.
As we said, ECG can be highly fallacious because myocardium is involved by stress cardiomyopathy, by MI, by pulmonary embolism, by cytokine storm, by myocarditis. So on the basis of ECG, it becomes very difficult what is producing. Serum markers are highly fallacious. One of the things, this has been studied by many, one of the things, if you have an wall motion abnormality strictly localized to an area of coronary artery.
Sir, but then AVF and RCA territory can overlap and can have a very myriad, even in a normal otherwise.
Otherwise, you have to get specialized tests, which are, for example, CMR will tell you that there's subendocardial, but that is not possible and we not like to cover
it. Not allowed.
Diagnosis is very problematic because of all these. Because of the myocardium hit by so many factors.
Yeah.
Pulmonary embolism.
Could it be thrombolyzed or could we won't? We have to wait.
Thrombolyzed can only be done unless you are not sure. Thrombolysis cannot be done. You have to be very sure that this is.
Yes.
sometimes there may be real problem because myocardium is hit by so many factors. And serum markers are highly fallacious. ECG is also highly fallacious. You can have epicardial. Many patients have been diagnosed TEMI. They were found to have near normal coronary arteries. So that is a real problem. We agree.
And if these patients recover eventually, they have a long-term sequelae, sir? Likewise, it happens with any post-myocarditic or something?
See, the recovery will depend on, because there are multiple problems in the myocardium. Now, how much affection is because of stress, cardiomyopathy, pulmonary embolism, cytokine storm, multifactorial. So we cannot predict the recovery. In usual cases, acute myocardial infarction, we know this is only one cause hitting the myocardium, so we can predict. But here, predicting recovery is a very problematic because so many things are hitting the myocardium. So what is the contribution of this? An unpredictable story. Usual MI, everything, you know, this is RCA problem, this, other myocardium. So that is a this is a highly unpredictable problem. COVID is.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I have one observation.
Yes.
For so far as government agencies and the government itself is concerned, the pandemic is over. They have done lockdown now. You are on your own now. For us, the pandemic begins now, because now people are going to roam about. They will be free on road to go to and travel to any hospital. Nobody is going to screen them properly, whether you are in a yellow zone or green zone or whatever nonsense they were labeling. I think the worst time for physicians and cardiologists actually begins now. We need to be doubly careful now.
As we have discussed with many other persons, the only way to make this go away earlier is let it allow to spread, develop herd immunity, and then
prevent it from spreading.
It will continue 6 months, 1 year. Because in our country, at least the mortality still remains 3%, which is not unusual because patients who have diabetes, MI, other things, they will die. So 3% mortality even at 1,25,000 is right. So I think we should not try to catch the virus. Let it spread. We cannot catch the virus. It will continue to spread and is spreading. And if the herd immunity develops, then only the progress. Because
we should start working, dispel our fears. And avoid.
It's not a deadly disease, at least in the young working class. All of us are older. We should be more careful. But in the usual age of, say, before 55 and 30 or 25 to 35, I think they should be allowed to work freely. And disease, if somebody gets sicker, he should go to the hospital, get it treated. You cannot contain everybody like this. 2 months already over, I think the results are not as we had expected.
I think, sir, the most important thing which I feel that post-lockdown is the mental health, because we have started seeing patients with depression.
Yes.
We are already 2-3 patients admitted with suicidal attempt, and there are so many problems we are going to face. I think with little bit precautions, that's good enough. And, we should learn to live with this all. Yes. And at least we should keep mental health should be good. Otherwise, that will create a hell of a problem in next coming months.
You should follow the slide which I have given.
Good.
Mask, everything, hand washing, distancing, that will be of great help and is of great help. We have been working for 2 months in hospital. None of the hospitals are because very strict. Even if I enter the hospital, I will be screened every day with temperature and everything. So that really matters. And none of us till date have developed COVID. And of course,
we get herd immunity.
That's more important.
That is the view of many others, because unless you have a herd immunity, the virus will not find whom to attack.
Right.
Every 50% or 60% affected, then it will not spread once in a while. So that, I think, is, although the government will never agree for this.
Okay.
So I think we had a very lively discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Bye, Prashant.
Bye, Idris. Very nice meeting you. Very nice hearing you. Wonderful exposition. Bye, Manuriya, sir. Somani, sir.
Bye, Prashant. Vithut,
sir.
Bye. Thank you, everyone.
Bye, Team MQ. Trivedi, sir. Follow women.
Yes.
So you want to speak, Kajal? Go ahead.
That is the most fruitful message.
Take home message.
From the audience.
Let Kajal speak.
Yes, sirs, we had a couple of questions from the audience. If you could take it up in 5 minutes.
I think now you can send an email, we will reply you because it's already too late.
Okay.
All right, sir. No issues, sir.
You can send an email, I think, to all.
Most of us. So on behalf of MQ, sir, I thank all of you, all the esteemed faculty that we have today, and hope for another collaboration again, sir. Thank you and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye, Manoria.
Thank you, sir.
मीटिंग थोड़ी थोड़ी आएगी मीटिंग ऐसा नहीं बोलते तो उसके देखने में क्या लगता है एक उसको लीड करो उसको लीड करो ये पेस्ट कर लेंगे बस